G'day, church. My name's Greg Scott. You probably know me for wearing odd shoes and odd socks around, but I've got the same ones on today, just for fun. Anyway, today is the first Sunday of September, Father's Day, as some would remember, and hopefully the fathers have all been well spoilt today. Thank you for joining us today in church, and we appreciate your time and appreciate your coming to worship in this unique and special way. This week also saw the beginning of September, beginning of spring, and that is also obviously a bit warmer weather and a bit easier going and a bit more comfortable to get around and get out if we can, as best we can. So welcome to church, and I hope that today you are lifted by the Spirit and that you are enthused by the Son and enjoyed by the Father. Amen.
Hey, boys and girls and parents too, it's Anne, and I'm here again to tell you about what's exciting and happening this weekend. Now, I know the kids' curriculum can be really fun, like the fact that Jimmy's show is actually looking at the coolest five Spider-Man characters of all time. And I know that the Scuppets have superheroes too. But I really think that this week the story is the coolest, because Matthew was a guy who was a tax collector, and tax collectors were people who took money from people and sometimes took a little bit more for themselves. So people didn't really like them. But when Jesus came, he got to know Matthew, and he went to Matthew's home, and he got to know Matthew's friends, and Matthew's life was so changed. He became a disciple of Jesus. And he was with him till the end. And you know what? Matthew loved Jesus so much. He even wrote a book in the Bible so that we could know more about Jesus. So even though you're going to learn about some superheroes, I still think Matthew might be the cooler kid this weekend. It's great to see you guys. And it's great to have time to talk about Matthew and how his life was changed. But there's something else that's important, and that is, if you as a kid in our kids' church decide that you want to be changed and have a relationship with Jesus, well, guess what? It's a great topic of conversation to have with your parents. And if you guys need help, there's a booklet on our website that will help you lead your child through that process. Thanks so much for spending time with us today, and I hope you have a great week. Bye.
Thank you.
Let's pray. Thank you, God, that we can worship you and come to this place. Thank you that we are in our own places at the moment, and we thank you that we can worship you wherever we are. And we thank you that you are in our hearts and ready to be moved within us, so that we can listen to your word and respond to your word in the ways that you call us to do, whether that's with our hands or with our heads or our hearts or our eyes wide open. May we have a heart ready to serve you. May people see that our eyes are open for you in the eyes of love, compassion and care. We all have a life, so we all have the opportunity to love. Let's take it. Amen.
James chapter 2, verses 1 to 13. My brothers and sisters, believers in our glorious Lord Jesus Christ, must not show favoritism. Suppose a man comes into your meeting wearing a gold ring and fine clothes, and a poor man in filthy old clothes also comes in. If you show special attention to the man wearing fine clothes and say, "Here's a good seat for you," but say to the poor man, "You stand there," or "Sit on the floor by my feet," have you not discriminated among yourselves and become judges with evil thoughts? Listen, my dear brothers and sisters. Has not God chosen those who are poor in the eyes of the world to be rich in faith and to inherit the kingdom he promised those who love him? But you have dishonored the poor. Is not the rich who are exploiting you? Are they not the ones who are dragging you into court? Are they not the ones who are blaspheming the noble name of him to whom you belong? If you really keep the royal law found in Scripture, love your neighbor as yourself, you are doing right. But if you show favoritism, you sin and are convicted by the law as lawbreakers. For whoever keeps the whole law and yet stumbles at just one point is guilty of breaking all of it. For he who said, "You shall not commit adultery," also said, "You shall not murder." If you do not commit adultery, but do commit murder, you have become a lawbreaker. Speak and act as those who are going to be judged by the law that gives freedom, because judgment without mercy will be shown to anyone who has not been merciful. Mercy triumphs over judgment.
G'day, church, and a very special greeting to all the fathers this Father's Day. Really is one of the most important days of the year, and we should know that and respect that. And all fathers should just be spoilt and not have to work on Father's Day. So there's no sermon today. Just joking. It doesn't seem to work that way all the time, does it? But happy Father's Day to all of you fathers. We're speaking today on the book of James and the second chapter. I wonder how well you think it is that God can use you. So answer some of these questions for me, just in your head. Ask, are you a natural leader? Because if you answer no, then probably, to be realistic, God can't use you as well as some others. But perhaps you're a talented musician. No? Well, then I guess God can't use you as much as even more other people. Are you young and are you really healthy? Because if not, then I guess you're kind of not really going to be much use, really, are you? But perhaps you're wealthy. You know, I could really go on here, couldn't I? These are the lists that we make in our head about ourselves, you know. I'm not a charismatic personality. I'm not someone of high intelligence. So we mark ourselves below other people and we develop these insecurity complexes. Now, that's destructive enough that we do that. What's even more terrible is when we mark other people exactly the same way. We look at them and we decide that they don't match up with some set of criteria that we think is what's needed. So, I mean, those people are welcome to hang around, for sure. I mean, it's not like we're prejudiced or anything. Come on. It's just that those sorts of people don't have a real lot to offer, do they? Well, I hope by now you're throwing things at the TV. Hopefully you haven't switched it off. But you should be throwing something, because that's just really obnoxious, what I just said. And the Bible says quite the opposite. The Bible says it makes no difference to God today whether you're young or old, highly educated or not, famous or unknown. He wants you to know him and he wants you to know his passion for knowing you. And God doesn't love you more or less according to whatever criteria, the colour of your skin, the clothes on your body. He doesn't judge people like that. He's not impressed by the cars we drive, or he probably laughs at what we think is the height of fashion when we put it on. He's not concerned whether we have more degrees than a thermometer. But rather, this is a consistent message through Scripture. So, for instance, 2 Chronicles 19:7 tells us, "With the Lord our God there is no injustice or partiality." Partiality just means favouritism. And of course, people are different. That's part of the genius of God's creativity, that nobody is the same. But we go wrong when we start judging the values in the way that people are different. Deuteronomy 10:17 says, "The Lord your God is God of gods and Lord of lords, the great God, mighty and awesome, who shows no partiality." That's just one of the most worshipful verses in all of Scripture, and it chose to point out that God is impartial. The prophet Samuel was told when he went looking for someone that he was just desperate for someone God could use. "People judge by outward appearance," God said, "but I look at the heart." And he found the one that he did find, nobody else would have chosen. David, of course, was the youngest, and in the eyes of his brothers and probably even his own father, he was the runt of the litter. But God said, "Is a man after my own heart, he's going to be the king of Israel." And as you read through the Bible, you just notice how time after time, God picks people that nobody else would have judged as worthy to be picked. Most of the time, they even would have, in fact, very often they do, try to even rule themselves out, sure that God has made a mistake. The fact is, we often look in the mirror and we don't like what we see. But God didn't make a mistake when he made each of us. James chapter 2, verse 1 says, "My brothers and sisters, believers in our glorious Lord Jesus Christ, must not show favoritism." So we're not supposed to superficially evaluate a person's worth based on nothing but what we can see of them from the moment, from the outside, from the surface. James is categorical here to tell us that showing favoritism is absolutely incompatible with being a Christian. It's not a, gee, it would be nice if we get around to this. This is core that we don't act that way. In verse 9, he says, "If you do that, you break the most important law of God, the royal law." Just pause for a moment and let that sink in. God is passionate about this. Remember, in John 1, we're told the Word became flesh and went camping with us, pitched his tent with us. That's a message that God chose to be family with us. And when we get that, whatever growing up was like or whatever the word family means to you, it really should help us not to feel inferior or superior to anyone else. You're just amazingly blessed. Because the most important person in the universe, the King of Kings, doesn't just want to be your friend, but really wants to bring you into his family forever. The most important VIP in the universe has come to meet you, find you, love you, and invite you into his forever family. Mind-boggling thought. So James says, "Hey, brothers and sisters, given all that, don't play favourites. That's just dumb. It goes against everything that God has just done." And the perverse thing is that he needed to say specifically that this should not happen in our gatherings. Now imagine, James says, you know, Mr. Goldfinger pulls up outside your service on the latest, model camel, and he's blinged up. He's literally a gold-fingered man. He's got gold rings stacked on his fingers. Very few poor people could afford a gold ring in the times that James was writing. But the most ostentatious people in the ancient world would wear rings on their thumbs and every finger, except usually the middle finger, sometimes up to 6 rings on a finger. It was even a kind of way to bank your wealth, because you could always remove a ring and exchange it for anything that was needed. And so this guy is kind of that picture. His clothes are dazzling, he's loud, he's flashy. So what do we do with him? Well, actually, we're meant to welcome him, to love him, to tell him that King Jesus became poor for his sake when he came to die for his sins. And now he's alive in order to bring him his love and grace as well. So treat this man the very best you can, so that he knows God loves him. In the synagogues of the time, there really weren't seats for everyone or even benches to sit on. A lot of people would have just sat cross-legged on the floor. But it may be that I'm so dazzled by, you know, Mr. Goldfinger getting him into the service, ushering him up to the best seat, probably seating him right next to an offering plate, I'd suggest. And I'm so busy doing that I don't even notice a beggar who only owns one piece of clothing. It's old and it's filthy, he lives and he sleeps in it. Now, there's nothing wrong with giving the first guy a place of honour, literally an elevated seat, so long as we do the same to the poor man too. But if I don't, if I judge by appearances and I make a prejudgment about him, then I've simply let my prejudices run wild. I become a judge with evil intent. Without even thinking about it, I've valued that rich are better than the poor. James says that's not now, that's no more. Now, we're all one family. And he particularly picks out money as the thing around which our prejudices often run. How do we use our money? Listen to what he says. Listen, my dear brothers and sisters, has not God chosen those who are poor in the eyes of the world to be rich in faith and to inherit the kingdom he promised to those who loved him? But you've dishonored the poor. Is it not the rich who are exploiting you? Aren't they not the ones who are dragging you off into court? Are they not the ones, like in every society, in every period of history, are they not the ones who have the power to hurt you? Are they not the ones who are blaspheming the noble name of him to whom you belong? Well, nothing's changed, of course. We live in a world where I'm told that no more than 8 families own more than the poorest half of humanity. But that staggering inequity continues down even to the level that you or I live on. The world is inherently unfair. And James is saying that as we live in this unfair world, that how we spend our money demonstrates whether or not we bear the family resemblance, which family we belong to. So he's not saying that to be rich is bad. The more you have, the more good you may choose to do with it. But the Bible says about Jesus that though he was rich, yet for our sake he became poor, that we through his poverty might be made rich. Rich in the ways that matter most and last forever. So Jesus spent his time, of course, not in the palaces with the influential who had it all, but in places of poverty with those people who had nothing. I read last week that this year, because of the coronavirus, the world is facing a bigger hunger emergency than ever before in history, which could double the number of people facing acute hunger, an estimated to 265 million people by the end of this year. I know our government announced this week that we're in recession, but we've still got it so easy in comparison, haven't we? Holiday places for Australians like Bali that so many Australians give little other thought to have seen a rise in the rates of something called, oh yeah, starvation. Proverbs 28:27 says, "He that gives to the poor shall not lack, but he that hides his eyes," in other words, refuses to see, "shall have many a curse." He who gives to the poor shall not lack, but he that hides his eyes shall have many a curse. That's wisdom, isn't it? And it's a promise for the generous that we can give and give and that God will bless those who obey him in this way. I love the amusing story. David Watson told a story. He knew an old farmer who was always giving away money for God's crazy amounts of money, yet he never seemed to lack. And he was asked how it worked, and the farmer said, well, God just keeps filling up my barn, and I go in there and I throw it out, but he keeps throwing it in. His shovel is bigger than my pitchfork. But here's my point. The way we use our money is a key indicator of our prejudices. It shows which family we belong to. It shows which people, or even perhaps sometimes just which person, being me, in the whole world that I think highly of. We're all susceptible to different things. Let me ask you this. What's your favourite prejudice? Maybe you're someone in this world who does have less money, and so you really enjoy judging people with more. And it's such fun to make assumptions about them, isn't it? Or it might be some other private conviction we always check out in other people. You know, things like everyone who lives up in the upper mountains, they're all into the New Age. Or people from the North Shore, they're all just greeny nimbies. Or people from Melbourne, no, I'm not going to say that one because jokes about Melbourne just really aren't very funny anymore, are they? But nowadays in church, we might not be impressed by someone who comes in and has plenty of gold rings on their finger. That's a thing not so much of this age. But what if they have a golden voice? Well, of course they're welcome then. They can come right on up and they can sing in the band and we can give them more time or a place of great prominence because of their evident musical gifts. This is going to be so wonderful. But what about their character? Are they prideful or gossiping or divisive? Because, you know, in these roles, character trumps gifts every time. But and here's the problem. It's hard not to be dazzled by the externals. All too often it takes time for character to be revealed or given away. Now, in order to get through life, unfortunately, we do often need to make very fast and thus superficial judgments. We don't always have time to sit and assess everything that comes across our path in the way that we would like to. So very often we draw these judgments. We can't help but do this. We draw them from a subconscious bank of assumptions. We're not really even aware of what they are. I'll tell you an amusing story. I was listening to a woman being interviewed on the radio. She held a job in Australia as an anti-discrimination commissioner. So she just fought discrimination day in, day out. And she was admitting that her daughter had come home from school and asked her a series of questions that they'd been given as an exercise at school designed to show our unconscious biases. And to this woman's horror, in answering a question about a hypothetical doctor, the female anti-discrimination commissioner found that she had assumed that the doctor would be male. We all do things like that. And at that level, I think the best medicine is to laugh at ourselves and fix the assumption for the next time. But we do need to be self-aware. And the best way that you can change your mind and challenge stereotypes and break prejudices is actually when you meet people who are different and discover they're different. If you've never met Hindu people, go and meet some. If you've never met Muslim people, honestly, you'll be amazed at how warm and human. And if you've never met people like that, you can build up these images from the media. But just go and meet them. We don't want a planet full of Philip Wars. What would that look like? You wouldn't want to listen to the music, I promise you. And you probably wouldn't want to trust any bridges that were built. I wouldn't even want to live on a world like that. But God loves to paint using every colour and shade. He invented diversity. I was at a pastor's retreat group some years back, and there happened to be a pastor there who originated from Africa, a black African man, and another pastor, white man, who came from the USA. And in the group, we were sharing the context that we'd grown up in and the different cultures, and the ones from different cultures were particularly interesting to listen to. And I was fascinated by American brother's story because he'd grown up in a school that was a fairly rough school and apparently quite regularly had group fights, mini riots really, between the black and the white students who attended that school. So he's some just amazing stories to tell us. And we broke for a lunch break, and when we came back, the American pastor did something very unexpected. Without saying anything to anyone, he brought a dish of water and a towel into the room. He proceeded to remove the shoes of his African brother and to wash his feet. As he did that, he explained to all of us that he felt the need to do something actual and demonstrative as a small way to show that he had gospel values now, not the prejudices that he grew up with. Now, I could tell you, some of us were in tears. It was really a holy moment. And rethinking about that as I was writing this message, I thought about how I felt a few weeks ago when Gloria graciously and forgivingly shared about how she had been excluded at times in our church. That didn't feel holy. Not at all. So I got convicted to do something demonstrative and on behalf of us all. So this week I sent her a bunch of flowers, just with a bit of a note to say sorry about that and to thank her for her grace in still loving us. Why was I so convicted about that? Because of what James says here. Discriminating against another person who God made and loves breaks God's heart and it breaks his royal law. And if you really keep the royal law found in Scripture, love your neighbour as yourself, you're doing right. But if we show favouritism, we sin and we're convicted by the law as lawbreakers. In every situation where God encounters people, here's what happens. No matter the face that appears before him, the response that God always has to that face, no matter what the race or the gender or the age or their capacity, God's response is love. I want to get to that point where I don't care how someone presents, but you feel that motivation that God has toward them flow through you. And that love that God shows includes you and me, thank God. No matter how many times and in so many ways you might have been wrong and done wrong, he still says, I love you, I forgive you, I want you in my family. If you want to talk about anything that this subject might have raised for you, please contact me. I'd love to talk with you because, you know, we are one family now and that's how God means it to be. So God bless always.
Thank you.
how did you go to church? There's a lot of practical things within the book of James, and Phil has given us a lot of guidance as to how to put that into practice in our daily lives. Maybe there's something there that you can work on today. Maybe there's something you can work on for this week and gradually make a habit of in your daily lives. So don't be afraid. There's plenty of people around to support and encourage and help you along the way. So be encouraged and take up the challenge. Do something practical, make something real, and show no prejudice, show no favoritism, but love as one family. Have a good week.